when you exercise, your brain is receiving signals from your body that really tell you who you are and what you're capable of. And so when we talk about exercise being, you know, boosting confidence or being empowering, sometimes we think about it like very abstractly, but I think about it very literally.
Welcome to the Spartan DEKA series on Spartan Up with Jared Cogswell, Director of Sport, and Yancey Culp, Director of Programming.
What's up, Spartans? Listen, we're coming back to you again with Kelly McGonigal. And I'm going to tell you right now, I would give anything if I could have had this in my life before I started coaching. This episode is full, packed full of so many mic drop moments. Have your pen and paper ready. Be ready to hit the pause button and take notes, folks. This one is a pull you to the edge of your seat episode that you and everybody in your life, I don't care what industry you're in, you need to listen and watch this one. Much love.
This episode of Spartan Up is brought to you by the Exogen Ultrasound Bone Healing System. Exogen is a non-invasive treatment option that can help heal your broken bone. To learn more, visit exogen.com/Spartan.
You know, Kelly, you talked too about there being this piece of connectivity when it comes to stress, caring, compassion, and it creating resilience. You know, like mm-hmm. It actually, those types of things. And it just meshed so well because Yancey and I did a 5-part series of trying to get people off that roller coaster ride of fitness. And we started with you have to have a purpose. You know, you can't just go out there and exercise. We believe in training and that we're all athletes in this game called life, right? But tell us a little, because I thought that was really cool, the connectivity, the community piece that you talked about in the TED Talk.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many ways to go into this. One of the things that is really clear is that the degree to which you feel connected to other people and to communities is a huge source of resilience. So, you know, for example, if you are somebody who's well integrated into a community you care about, and then you experience something really stressful, like losing your job or getting divorced, it's less likely to take a toll on your physical health or your mental health. You know, people who are connected live longer. But it's a particular type of connectedness. So the research is really clear that it's about being connected in a way where you feel like you are valued by your community and you have something to offer your community that is the sort of the best kind of social connectedness. It's, you know, it's why people who volunteer show, you know, so many incredible health and mental health benefits. And I think that, you know, part of it is because when you talk about what compassion is, people who haven't studied it, sometimes think of it as like being nice, like, or being kind in like a soft way. But compassion is this really interesting state of your brain and of your body that looks a lot like courage. It's a form of courage. And when you notice that there's somebody who is struggling in some way and you believe that you have something to offer, that you can help, you can do something, you can give advice, you can give support, you can be there for them, it activates your brain in ways that dampen down stress and anxiety, that activate the hope circuit of the brain, which is the part of your brain that makes you think something good could happen, that makes you want to approach rather than retreat or hide. It's this incredibly empowering state. And it's great in terms of your physical health. So when you're connected to that state of wanting to help and feeling like you can help, you've got all of these hormones circulating in your bloodstream, like oxytocin, which are antioxidants and anti-inflammatory, and help regulate your cardiovascular system. It's just, there's something about that particular state of mind or mindset. It's like your brain says, okay, I guess it's really important for you to be engaged with life and to be here. So we're just going to orchestrate this whole state of mind and body to help you thrive because it's clear that you have a purpose and that your purpose is bigger than yourself. So, and I think that it's one of the reasons, I know I keep coming back to fitness and athletics and that sort of thing, but I think it's one of the reasons why there's been a lot of research looking at the mental health benefits of different types of movement, and group movement always seems to come out on top, whether it's a group X program, whether it's strength training, you know, within a community or a gym, whether it's a walking club, a running group, whatever it is, sports, recreationally. And I think it's because all of these things allow you to both receive and offer support. And, you know, I see this in, you know, my husband, who is now an ultra runner. When he got started, he was training for a half marathon, and now he's doing these unbelievable distances that I can't even imagine. But his favorite parts of these races, and that he does cycling ones too, is like that moment where somebody needs a sock and he's able to give them a sock, you know? It's like these moments where you're all doing something hard and none of you can do it on your own. You just have to be willing to accept help. And you know there's going to be a moment where you're going to help someone else who feels like they can't go on any longer. And I feel like that actually pretty much any group movement is going to give you the chance to do that. Even if it's just like somebody asking me what type of sneaker is great for this class. And like, oh, I love your shoes. Oh, where'd you get them? And I see that sort of thing happening in my classes. And it's this wonderful interdependence. And that's the type of connectedness that is so great for resilience.
This leads me to my next question. So from an elementary level, JC and I have been doing it for about 50 years combined, and we've seen the magic. We've seen it, the magic happen. We talk to a client before class. We see it happen during class sometimes. We see it happen a year after the class. We've seen the magic of what movement does for people. And it's, I love how you say group movement always comes out on top, because we believe that. And I know you've kind of, you've thrown some pieces at us in various parts of this podcast, but give us that big umbrella over exactly what's going on from the neuroscience and the exercise physiological perspective of right in that moment when we're in class and we're exercising. And because I've heard you say it in all these various things that I dove into today and several days ago, I just want that, give us that punch for our listeners.
Okay. Well, let's start with three things, because there's a whole lot of stuff going on. So let me try to give three that people might be able to connect with, because they won't necessarily all resonate with everyone equally. But let's talk about something that's true whether or not you are in a group. And that is how exercise changes your brain chemistry to improve your mood. So, and this is going to be for pretty much any form of movement that gets your heart rate up, that requires you to breathe more deeply, and that uses your muscles. So it's like everything. The first thing that happens is almost immediately you get a boost of adrenaline and dopamine, which gives you more energy. So it's why if you can make it through the first few minutes of a warm-up, whatever type of movement you're doing, you almost always feel better and more like you want to do it. So something I really want people to remember and keep in mind, that how you feel when you start is going to change very quickly. If you can get over that initial the feeling of fatigue or I don't want to do it, it's the doing it, the getting started, that often creates the desire to keep going. So you've got that adrenaline, you've got that dopamine. By the way, music also immediately releases dopamine and adrenaline, which is why I think the right playlist is an excellent way to get your movement started, including if you're somebody like, if you love to go for a run and you like to be out in nature, like maybe just listen to one song for your warm up, get everything super engaged and ready to enjoy it. And then you can contemplate nature and your own thoughts, you know, after the music has helped, or listen to music sort of before you go for your run while you're tying up your shoes, and that'll help too. So that's the first thing that happens. And then if you continue to persist at around the 20-minute mark, that's where you start to see the true exercise high, which is when the brain is now releasing higher levels of endorphins and endocannabinoids, which are these brain chemicals that give you energy, make you feel physically better, like you could keep going, that also make you more optimistic, and that enhance pleasures and make us better able to connect with other people. So it's why also, by the way, I know you will know this is true, teaching group exercise, 20 minutes in, aren't people more willing to do like team stuff or make eye contact with you? There's something about you need to get that exercise high going. People who would be like, don't talk to me, I'm here in my zone, suddenly are much more open to connection once that chemistry is kicked in. But what's great about that exercise high is it's kind of like an upward spiral. So you might feel great during the workout, or you feel better. You feel great afterwards. You've also got that like achievement sensation. That's like, I did something for myself, or I did something hard, and that's amazing. But that brain chemistry, even though it doesn't continue like on an upward climb once you stop exercising, it creates enough of a change that researchers have found that you are more likely to have continued positive mood for hours after you exercise. You're more likely to make progress on a goal that's important to you. You have more positive interactions with other people. And there's something about that neurochemistry of the exercise high that's basically setting you up to be the best version of yourself. So that is one thing to think about what's happening when the magic is happening. Now, another thing that's happening, let's talk specifically about group movement, is the synchrony effect. And we know that when you move in synchrony with other people, either literally, like the simplest example would be if you were step touching and clapping in like an aerobics class, and or you're all just jumping up and down at the same time, or you're all squatting down up to the beat of the music, that sort of synchrony. But it's also true if what is synchronized is your goal. So, you know, a lot of training situations, you're not all doing exactly the same movement at the same time. There might be different stations, and some people are running and some people are doing strength training and whatever's going on. And they might be doing it at their own time as well, going at their own pace. But if you're really clear about the shared goal and you have the sense that you're all in it together, you get this effect as well, which is that your brain starts to sense yourself as connected to everyone else you're moving with. And it starts to give you a big endorphin rush that is just like an exercise high amplified. And those endorphins do all the things that the exercise high does, but because you're doing it in a group, those endorphins also make you feel connected to the other people. They make you feel more trust, more belonging. And what's so interesting about group movement is it is both personally empowering and collectively empowering. So after somebody moves in a group, a yoga class, a strength training class, a dance class, they are more likely to feel that they are not alone in whatever their biggest challenges are and feel more confident that they can face their individual struggles. But they're also more likely to believe that the biggest problems in the world are solvable, or that it, you know, it's possible to make progress on society's biggest challenges, which is amazing. And let's be honest, this is a really good time for that sort of mindset when a lot of people are feeling overwhelming despair about all sorts of things that are going on in the world. So that's part of what's the magic is this moving in synchrony that is helping your brain tap into really the biology of hope, collective joy and collective hope. I said there was going to be a third, but let me just be quiet for a second and just see, do you have any thoughts about that? Do you feel these things yourself?
This is what just happened to me. So we bring new gems onto we onboard new gems in our affiliate program every week with DEKA. I remember when I would join the corporate world, they made me watch the fish video, the Pike's Fish Market up in Seattle. This freaking listening to you talk is going to be mandatory for our gym owners and our fit pros. It's so, there's just mic drop after mic drop.
Love this? Yeah, I have to say, I've been thinking about writing another book and I just can't make myself do it because the thought of having to talk about anything other than movement is breaking my heart, because this just, it's so amazing. And you see it. I know you see it every day.
We'll be right back to this interview, but first, a little bit from our sponsor, Exogen. Spartans, you know a broken bone can interrupt daily activities and even worse, keep you on the sidelines. Determining the best treatment option can be stressful. In just 20 minutes a day, Exogen helps jumpstart your natural bone healing process so you can get back to the race. Don't let a broken bone keep you on the sidelines. Talk to your doctor to see if Exogen is right for you. Exogen is indicated for the healing of non-union fractures and for accelerating the healing of certain acute fractures with no known contraindications. To learn more, visit exogen.com/Spartan. That's exogen.com/Spartan. Okay, back to the interview.
So let me go quickly to the third thing that's happening when we exercise that I think a lot of people will resonate with. And this is the idea that when you exercise, your brain is receiving signals from your body that really tell you who you are and what you're capable of. And so when we talk about exercise being, you know, boosting confidence or being empowering, sometimes we think about it like very abstractly, but I think about it very literally. Like if there's a kettlebell and it's heavy and you pick it up and you swing it, your brain is getting signals from the grip of your hands and the force on the muscle of your arms and how they have to pull and the tendon puts force on your bones and all of that. Your brain is getting signals about that. And the way your brain receives it is not this kettlebell is heavy or even like my biceps are and my deltoids are strong. Your brain integrates all of this information and it gets this cohesive sense of I am powerful. I am strong. And every form of movement has these like signature sensations that can be incredibly uplifting and empowering. So one of the reasons I love teaching dance is because I can choreograph in all of these movements of joy and hope. I don't even want to tell you how many times in dance class this morning, we did a gesture like this, where the arms are going up and the gaze is going up, because that is the signature embodiment of joy. And there's all this research, and when you do that movement, you feel joy. So I have a lot of joy choreography. But if you think about like yoga and feeling grounded and centered, or you think about running and feeling fast and free, like you're moving forward in life. So I always tell people, like, find a workout that makes you feel interesting things. That's why I love boxing, because it's just about the only thing in my life that does make me feel, not want to be brave, but to feel it, to literally feel that I'm capable of standing up for myself or fighting for what matters. I might want to be that in other parts of my life, but boxing makes me sense that this actually is part of who I am. So that's another thing that, and when people fall in love with a form of movement, I think a lot of it is because they're sensing a part of themselves that they value and maybe haven't had a chance to cultivate in other areas of their lives, or that maybe is not valued by the people in their lives as much, but you get to be that version of yourself in that movement form.
As a coach, Kelly, you know, we talk about, you know, when you put that coaching hat on, you're educating, you're motivating, you're inspiring. You know, like, trainers to me are just boring, right? They've got all the knowledge and all the skills, but I don't know if they're putting on that cap to keep bringing people back, right? I also believe, you know, one of our favorite coaches out there is Chris Hinshaw, who has had a dramatic impact on the CrossFit world. And he talks about being very intentional and purposeful when it comes to your, you know, just any given workout.
Yeah.
When you're in that group setting, you're dealing with all kinds of different personalities, different needs, different levels. What are you trying to achieve as a coach for them coming to your class and then leaving your class? What is your intention?
Yeah, I think about this a lot too. So one thing I always encourage people to do is to be clear about who they could have the most positive impact on. So, you know, there might be a lot of people coming to your classes or to your training space, but there's going to be a particular type of client or participant where you are medicine for them. You are what they need. And to double down on that rather than trying to be everything for all people. So I've listened very carefully to the feedback that I've gotten over years of teaching. And what the feedback that I now understand is my medicine is that, first of all, I don't infantilize or condescend to people who have movement challenges or people who in other workout settings, like, oh, you're old, that makes you cute. Or you have a disability, therefore maybe like be in the back row and modify, and maybe this isn't the right class for you. Like all these ways that people get excluded or not really seen in their full humanity. And so part of what I want to do is you show up, and I know you are strong. You may have physical challenges. It doesn't mean you're not strong. I know that you are a full human being with every possible emotion and desire, and you can express it in the setting, even if you think that's not seen or witnessed outside of this. So that's a big part of it. And there's like some people right now are being like, what does that have to do with training? But to see people in their full humanity is actually a big part of training, because it's part of what allows people to then go and lift the heavier weight. Or, you know, this morning in my dance class when we were doing a certain routine that requires a lot of attitude, and the women suddenly started showing more of that like confidence and bravado in their movement. Someone has to give you permission to do it so that you get to express that part of yourself. So that's part of what I'm trying to do, is think like really, truly, how do I make people feel like they are whole and human and I know it? And then the second thing is I construct movement patterns that I believe embody things that people want to feel. So my dance classes are like 70% joy, 30% power, is how I think about it. Movements that will make people feel powerful, and 70% movements that will make people feel joyful. In other formats that I teach, I may focus on other types of feelings, but I'm very serious about embodied psychology and how to cue people so that they get it. There's a big difference between punching with, you know, your hands and like fake fists versus strong fists. There's a big difference between punching with your core fully engaged and just moving your arms around. And if you don't coach the quality of movement that creates the psychology, you are shortchanging people because they don't know how to do it on their own. So I feel like that willingness to really coach movement quality, even if the people you're training don't view themselves as athletes or dancers or whatever, competitors, but you train them like they are if you really believe in the movement form that you're teaching.
I'm thinking about when somebody leaves your class, they're confident, they believe in themselves a little bit more before they walked in. They're connected with other people and they're smiling, you know, and that's a great dose.
That is my goal. And the other thing I will say that I do, which I try to do every class, and you know what, whenever I fail to do it, I actually regret it because I will probably end up doing or saying something that's just not quite right. And that is, I try to remember, so I was doing this today, walking over to teach class, to imagine the worst day of my life or the most difficult thing that I've had to deal with in my life or that I know that people in my life have had to deal with. And I say to myself, there's somebody in class today, that's their reality today too. They're walking out of a house with, you know, for example, I know that there are two people in my class today who are dealing with caregiving, one of a husband and one of aging parents. And it's incredibly difficult and stressful. It's such a complicated situation. And I always remind myself of that. And I think, and I don't always know what the situation is. I could be going into a room full of strangers giving like a talk at a conference. And I always say to myself, somebody in this room is having the worst day of their life. And so many people in this room are dealing with things that are invisible, but that's what the core of their reality. And I just say to myself, like, so could you please show up, Kelly, in a way that is respectful of that? And I don't always know exactly what that means, but there's something about that intention that's really important, because you have to imagine the person who's showing up today, they're doing this for survival. Like, this is maybe the only hour of the day where they're going to get a respite from something else that's really difficult. They want to be seen and smiled at. It'll matter if you know their name or not. If it's the worst day of their life, they don't want to be like, oh, are you new? No, I've been coming to your class for 3 months. Like, you don't want to be that person who that makes them feel invisible. So that's something that I think about a lot too. And I think that probably translates, you know, whoever you teach, wherever you teach.
Love that. That's great.
This episode of Spartan Up is brought to you by the Exogen Ultrasound Bone Healing System. Exogen is a non-invasive treatment option that can help heal your broken bone. To learn more, visit exogen.com/Spartan. Thanks for listening to this episode of the DEKA series on Spartan Up podcast. Spartan Up is your partner in resilience for mind, body, and spirit. We're here 3 days every week. Tuesdays, you can find Joe DeSena, founder and CEO of Spartan, interviewing biohackers, business leaders, authors, and athletes. Thursdays and Saturdays, catch episodes from our DEKA, Endurance, Trail, Combat, and La Ruta series. Do you know someone who needs a little nudge? Maybe they could use some motivation, tactics to be stronger, healthier, happier, more successful. Tell them about our show. And if you're watching on YouTube, leave us a comment. We want to know who's watching and who's listening. Thanks. See you next time.